Ham Radio Now, episode 202. Well, the bulk of this episode is going to be on DZ Kits with Brian Wood. W0DZ, he makes the DZ Kits, those radios that are pretty much like Heathkits, and as he says, the only kits available today where you actually have to do some soldering. And so we'll get to that in a couple of minutes, but as usual, I got a bunch of other stuff to do. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I'm here along with the bear in my lap as the co-host. And I guess I'll do this right away. Arvin is sitting back in his usual spot, wanting me to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you, so if you enjoy the programs, you get something out of them. Stop by HamRadioNow.tv and click on Arvin's icon and help us out. We're talking about you sending us money. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about is, the radio is turned on back there, but is the antenna connected? No. We are here, just west of Raleigh. This thunderstorm is on its way, so I'm going to leave the antenna disconnected for now. Okay, so the first thing I wanted to mention was that I saw this headline on QRZ.com a day or so ago from Skeeter Nash, letting us know that Bill Pasternak is back in the hospital. And as of this update, he was in intensive care. And I have a little update that I saw on their Facebook page that said he is doing a little better, but he's still in pretty bad shape. So we're going to pull for Bill. The announcement that Skeeter put on there was, of course, first concern for Bill. And we all hope that that he pulls through this and comes back as good as he can be. But that also Newsline is going to go out of production again. Well, Bill's in the hospital. Skeeter was saying that he had produced Newsline while Bill was in the hospital last time. And then when Bill got out, he was able to take it back. But Skeeter's got a promotion at work, which is a good thing. He's now the program director at the radio station that he works at. And that means he's going to be a much busier guy. So he doesn't have time to produce Newsline. And he was looking for people to help out. I have volunteered, and we're communicating a bit on what that might be, but my limit is going to be kind of the mechanical stuff, and that would take me, he thinks, a half a day a week. I think he's optimistic it's going to be more like a day a week, and that's time I don't have, but kind of a worthwhile cause. But I'm just talking about doing the mechanical stuff, a quick assembly of the sound from the people that record it into the final program. No way would I have time to do the actual production of writing and getting all that recorded and assembled. That's what I'm talking about. But there's a lot of work behind that. So in any case, if you're wondering what's happening to Newsline on your favorite repeater, that may be the story. No Newsline until things get put back together. Let's see. Okay, I know that I misspoke when I recorded the last episode, 201, on the Kickstarter and said that it was going to end on January 31st. And a lot of you are paying attention. And you saw that. So, no, it's July 31st that the Kickstarter will end. And when I tried to launch it, I discovered that a Kickstarter maximum is 60 days. They pretty much said that. But somehow I didn't quite read that into it. So I tried to launch it and it said, no, that's longer than 60 days. Make up your mind. Launch now, end in 60 days or wait. So I decided to wait and it will launch, I think June 2nd equals 60 days until July 31st. So that's the plan. The Kickstarter will launch on June 2nd, and at which point you will be able to watch and see how I carefully finagled that January 31 mistake. Here's a clue. Watch my lips very carefully. Okay, so what is next? Oh, I found W5KUB's archive on YouTube. I had mentioned in the last episode that I looked at W5KUB's website, and I couldn't find any archive of the material that he did at Dayton. And so I came across it. It's all on his YouTube channel. So you can find a lot of the interviews and the things that he did there. And he's edited them out, separated them so that you can see what they are. And let's look at one or two of them here. This one is inappropriately named Kathy at Dayton 2015, because it's not about Kathy, his wife. It is about this guy.
There we go. So Joe, what are we going to do first? What do you
who is a magician.
You got short sleeves, so it can't be nothing, right?
What nothing are
you
going to do first? Sleeves today. Okay.
Let me zoom in a little bit.
Just try not to hit your necklace. You know, there we go, because I hate to destroy your necklace. Yeah. Okay, and then we're going to take these two pieces like this. Now, the whole concept is to pull a solid through a solid. We have a solid knot. We have a solid neck.
So, no, this doesn't have anything to do with ham radio, just in case you were wondering, except everybody involved is
hands. Ready? 1, 2, 3 weeks ago, we did this trick, and it actually worked. Hang on a second. Ready? 1.
He's good.
2, 3. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness.
You tucked it a little too deep.
Okay.
you weren't.
All right, so
that's the
first one I recommend you go see. He's got, you know, he's got a bunch of other things. He's got, what have you got up there? An interview with Bob Heil. And the next thing on his YouTube channel is one of his roundtables, the most recent roundtable. Looks like an interview with some guys from Heard Island. But this is the next one I want to play, just a little bit of this one.
So I'm going to give each of you a microphone. You're a ham too? Are you a ham? Wow.
If you've been watching Ham Radio Now, you know that I've been harping on a concept about youth.
Wow, are you a ham?
And this is definitely some youth. They're all hams.
Freddie, can you get them in the camera okay?
Ranging in license class from technician to extra, and not necessarily in order of height.
My name is Zechariah.
Okay, now Zechariah is doing something that I encourage and have a hard time getting people to do at Dayton. And that is to talk loud into the mic.
WX4TVJ.
WX4, okay. And you?
Well, my name is Faith Hannah, and my call sign is WA4BBC.
She's
and
the
tomorrow,
extra.
A vanity call, which is A4FH, should be coming.
Yeah.
You got a new call coming tomorrow?
Yeah.
And what's it going to be?
AE4FH.
FH, okay.
So, wrong button there. Okay, so the thing I've been harping on with kids is, do we celebrate youth in ham radio that do old ham radio things as young hams? You know, the Morse code, CW operation, rag chewing on sideband, working contest, doing DX, or do we celebrate youth that do young ham things? And in this interview, you're not really going to find out so much. Yeah, I mean, he kind of will go.
You've got an extra. You got the same license I've got. Wow! And look, you're
shorter. Kind of go with old hams and young bodies thing, but not quite so much. He also runs into the same problem that I do when I'm talking to really young hams, and that is feeling awkward about how to interview them. Not so good at it.
Come over here, Hope. Come over this way. Turn around that way. Look at the camera. So Hope, you are.
This is what I want.
KM4IPF, right? Oh.
Yeah, so I'm pushing the wrong buttons like crazy here. So yeah, I have trouble interviewing really young hams.
My name is Hope, and I'm KM4IPF.
Because I kind of dumb it down.
And how long have you had
and
your license?
I'd really like to maybe? Just talk to them as if they're maybe not quite adults, but at a higher level.
Eight.
And so you've got your what
good.
License do you have?
I am technician.
You have a tech license, so we have a tech. And a general and an extra license, right?
Oh, yeah. And Tom, you need an audio guy to help you out there. So in addition to that, I went and bugged Tom some and stopped by his booth and took a look at some of the hardware that he's got. He's got lots of microphones and a little mixer. and a bunch of cameras. He does, of course, the live thing. So he's way ahead of what I do. And Jeff says he likes doing the live thing. And then I stopped by and talked to him for a little bit, but he was busy giving away stuff.
I'm going to go bug Tom Medlin.
He and Kathy were going through their chat room and giving away prizes. And in the course of
trying to give away some prizes,
I discovered what it takes to get an audience.
AC2 BR Louise won the LDJ auto antenna tuner. So great. Give us a couple days to get the information to LDG, and they'll ship it right out to you. Hambot's time on the internet is official time. This is for the Tentec Regal 707 microphone. Well, did we get a winner? Okay, we got a winner in the last. He had about 4 seconds left. We got a winner.
My heart was racing.
Yeah, wasn't it, though? Man, sometimes they make it really difficult to give stuff away. You know, we have to work so hard. I don't know why that happens, but you'd think people would jump right on this stuff. Let's see.
Well, Tom, you told me how I need to get more viewers for Ham Radio Now. I need to buy them.
Yeah, you got to buy these people off if you want them to watch, man. They don't watch for free. I'll tell you, let me tell you something, Gary. As soon as the prizes go, the people go, man.
The audience is gone.
The audience is gone, man. We have about 2 people that follow us once the prizes are gone. Okay. What are we doing?
I can't buy you guys. Sorry. I got nothing to give away. I'm not going to give away Arvin. And I'm not going to give away the roaming gnome. There we go. The roaming gnome back there. Sorry. And that's pretty much it. That's all I've got here. One more thing about Dayton, there isn't really a Comic-Con cosplay aspect to Dayton. Most people that attend the Dayton dress up as hams, sadly, though that may be. In some of the interview programs that I've done from a booth in Dayton, you see the crowd, the parade of ham radio wandering by in the background of the cameras, and there are some drinking games people have told me about as they watch those for the enormous bellies. There goes the bear, or the hams that go by on the scooters. And people that are watching for those things and taking a drink whenever they see one of them, they're going to get plastered pretty darn fast. So there's a little bit of a Comic-Con aspect, though, and it's starting to build up. And there's 3 people that I will feature for this. There's 4 or 5. So the first one is this one. This is Andy Anderson, N8VES. And I don't know if he started it, but you've been seeing his tower helmet for a long time. And in fact, this is a picture that I took back in 2001. And he, every year he makes it a little bit more elaborate. So that's, you know, kind of an early stage of it. You know, it's 2001. So that's like 15 years ago, 14 years ago. And that year I was kind of doing a PR deal, and I don't think I was the one that mentioned this originally, but the idea is this what we want our public face of ham radio to be? I think I may have softened my approach to that a little bit. But that year anyway, it was a little bit concerned that that was the public face of ham radio that appeared on the front page of the newspaper. Yeah, it makes us look a little goofy. I guess that's who we are. Another famous ham radio personality in terms of showing up looking a little bit unusual is Joe Eisenberg, K0NEB. Joe is the kit columnist, the homebrew columnist for CQ Magazine. And kind of surprised that there aren't more pictures of Joe and his cat in the hat. You know, he's not doing a full costume thing. And I've seen him at several other ham fests, and he doesn't wear the hat anywhere except Dayton. And then he announced he was going to wear the hat at Friedrichshafen in Germany. So those are the two ham fests that you've seen Joe as the cat in the hat. And I don't know who the 400 group is, but they managed to come up with some pictures that, well, from 2008, that help out a little bit. These guys, the three amigos, they appeared in a Ham Radio Now video. And there's Andy again with his tower hat, tower helmet. And this guy appeared briefly in a Ham Radio Now video that year. And he doesn't show up every year, but at least not dressed this way, but dressed as an astronaut. And what he was promoting was going around with an ATV camera. And it was playing out to folks out in the flea market. So there is that. And then finally, there is this young lady and I think her sister. And this is Kristen Andrews, KB3 OQV, and Jennifer Andrews, KB3 GXV. And for the past several years, she has been making this hairdo more and more elaborate.
Okay.
What did you do this year?
Added more onto the back and put a dipole in.
A dipole?
Yeah.
That's practically a curtain antenna. Whoa. It's all active, right? It really works.
The back one is inspired from when MFJ visited DX Engineering.
For the MFJ Day?
Yes.
At DX Engineering?
Yes, MFJ Day. So
it's too
DX
bright behind you there.
There you go. Now you can see it all.
Oh, there's a call sign on there. And how long does it take to get back to normal when you're all done?
About half an hour in a scalding hot shower.
Not too bad.
Not too bad.
Now, what do you do tonight so you can have it again tomorrow?
Take it down, wash my hair, and start over tomorrow morning. Yep, bright and early. So, having fun.
And how many pictures are you? You're keeping track of pictures.
I have actually lost count, but if you look, here's the actual list.
Okay. So.
And it just continues.
A genuine celebrity.
Oh, yes.
Thanks.
Maybe that'll show up on the front page of the Dayton paper sometime. I don't know. All right. It's time for our feature presentation. Brian Wood, W0DZ and DZ Kits. He'll explain it all to you. But if you've ever wondered what you want to say to a manufacturer, a sales rep, to somebody at a booth where they're selling stuff at Dayton, to make yourself less popular with them, and that has happened to me on apparently more than one occasion, this is what you say.
And I'd like to do not so much a sales pitch and more a story.
Okay.
But you can certainly talk about what the products are. Now hold this right up close, just
right.
Like that.
Like that.
CW operators do this. Phone operators, we're trying to
I'm
work.
Mostly a CW operator.
We're trying to work DX here. You know,
all right.
It's like I'm calling you, KN4AQ. Can't you hear me?
Okay, gotcha.
And then this is what happens. Okay, back to Dayton.
Who am I talking to?
I'm Brian W0DZ, owner and president of DZ Kit.
Okay, yeah, you got to get the sales pitch in there at least at the beginning.
Right.
What is DZ Kit?
DZ Kit is the modern equivalent of Heathkit. We sell transceiver kits that require soldering. It's the only high-performance kit on the market that actually requires you to use a soldering iron.
So I'm going to point the little point of view camera down at some of these things. Go through these one at a time. With the 10-second sales pitch on each one, what's the first thing on the left there?
Okay, this is a Sedona, and what it is an accessory box that allows you to install a user-configurable PC, a mini ITX motherboard that you can configure however you want. You get it from wherever you want. We just provide the mounting holes, and then room to put other stuff. So you can put a software-defined radio in here and access it. It also gives you a 12-button keypad that provides direct band access for Sienna. and a voltage and current monitor.
Okay, so it's a utility box.
It's a utility box, right.
And you, pretty much anything that you want to try to stick in it.
Yep, we've even tried an Anon 10, the Apache Labs SDR 10-watt rig, and it fits right in here.
Why would somebody want to have something like that? Well, tell you, let's look at the rest of the stuff, and then I'll try to figure out why someone won't want to have that.
All right.
Okay. So what's the next box?
So this is our main product. This is Sienna. It's a general conversion receiver and a ham band transmitter from 160 through 10. It'll actually receive
typical 100 watts.
Typical 100 watts, but it's configurable. This is the 10-watt transmitter, and then there's a 100-watt amp underneath over here. This tray rotates up for service and access. And so you can get it without a transmitter, without an amp, without an antenna tuner, just as a receiver, and then upgrade it as your funds allow, or, you know, for whatever you want.
Okay, so speaking of funds, where do we start?
It starts at $1,700 and works its way up to $5,000.
So
it's a typical price for a 100-watt with normal options would be about $3,500.
All right, so it's not cheap.
It's not cheap.
It's in the range of most of the medium price, medium to high-end
right.
transceivers. Is performance... Justify all of that?
Performance is extraordinary. The transmit intermod distortion is 40 dB PEP at 100 watts. That's one of the best on the planet. We have a balanced mic input all the way to the shielded balanced input all the way to the transmitter. Low distortion, high quality audio circuitry. A three-band parametric equalizer, okay.
And the list goes on and on.
Let me turn
you around here to the main camera again a little bit.
Sure.
So for that price, you get to build it yourself.
You get to build it yourself.
How hard is it to build?
It's not hard. We do the surface mount soldering. So all of the, and the transmitter, the receiver board, the controller board, all the real complicated things are tested. And so what you do is you build the DC power conditioning board, the RS-232 interface, the front panel, the IF filters, that kind of thing, and then integrate it all.
I was going to say you mount discrete components and solder them on a board, but there aren't any more.
Well, yes, there are.
There are some.
In fact, you can look right in here.
Okay, yeah.
There's some of them right there. Those are all through-hole parts.
Okay, so those are things you solder. Plenty to do.
That we assemble. And this controller board we assemble for you.
Okay.
But the other boards are all through hole.
All right. Have you ever thought about letting people do their own surface mount? My friend Jeff, AC4ZO, is a surface mount expert. He thinks it can be done.
Well, it can be done. The problem is kitting it. Resistors have the values stamped on them. Capacitors do not. So if you lose one, you'll never figure out whether it's a 100 puff or a 1,000 puff capacitor.
Yeah.
You just, the kitting job of SMT is just too hard.
Have you ever heard of the element bismuth?
Yeah.
Okay, you know what bismuth is.
Sure.
These guys don't, except for the ones that watch the show with Jeff.
Okay.
Would you be impressed if I told you I know what we use bismuth for?
Well, Pepto-Bismol has it in it.
Okay, that's
bismuth subsalicylate.
No. What I'm thinking of is it will, if you mix it with a soldered board, it will lower the temperature so you can... take a, well, I guess mostly for cleaning a board off, you can desolder with it.
Okay.
Because it will lower, if you kind of mix it in with the solder real quick, and then it lowers the temperature, and you can practically wash things off a circuit board.
Interesting. Well, I mean, we do actually load all the surface mount ourselves, you know, and it's doable. You put one dollop of solder on one pad, and then tweezer the part down on top of it, heat it up, and then heat the other side up. And we do that with thousands of parts, and it works just fine.
All right. So I didn't mean to go off on the flight of fancy. I just thought I would,
since we were talking
surface mount, I'd see if we go anywhere. The instruction manual. You say that you're kind of like Heathkit. And I think I looked at your manuals a couple of years ago. They looked very Heathkit-ish.
Yeah, they do.
So
did you want to see one?
Follow that model? Yeah, let's take a look.
Okay. Right over here. So for those who may not be familiar with Heathkit, there's an old...
I was going to say, it looks so much like Heathkit, it even says Heathkit on it.
Yeah, that is a Heathkit assembly manual.
Okay, and you got an old Heathkit radio.
And this
Which
one
is
this,
that?
The HW101.
All right.
And as you can see here, it had very detailed step-by-step instructions on how to put the parts on the board.
Yeah, I built several. Not thousands, but I built several.
And then if you look at our manual, which is coincidentally yellow.
Similar color, not exactly, but
not exactly the same.
I was going to say that one may have faded a bit.
It turns out you can't get this kind of cover anymore. It's a leatherette cover.
Uh-huh.
They don't make it anymore. But we have the same kind of step-by-step instructions, detailed pictures and drawings that show where everything goes.
All right.
There's another example
showing. It is Heathkit-ish. So we'll take a look at the rest of the equipment in the line in just a second. Make sure we're still on camera. We still are. I can't afford a cameraman, so it just has to sit there by itself. You have probably seen the occasional online references to a Heathkit company coming back.
I have.
I suspect you have a strong interest in that possibility. What have you been able to glean from it? They've been very, very
Well, it turns out that we actually were one of the companies that bid on the intellectual property. When they put it up for auction a couple of years ago, the guys that won it, they won't tell us what they paid for it, but we and a former vice president of Heathkit went in together to try and get that name. And we didn't win it, obviously. The guys who did say they want to remain in stealth mode. They don't want people to know who they are. They announced they were going to come out with an SDR a year ago, and they never did.
Yeah.
So
they missed some deadlines. I don't know if they were firm deadlines, but they had said they were going to do some things, and nothing's ever come of it.
And if you go to their website now, you'll see that there's a little bit of activity. So, I mean, I'm pulling for them.
It gets people excited.
You know, I want the Heathkit name to survive, so
yeah.
I hope they do well.
But you've got a product that...
We already have a
that
product.
...that should satisfy people. You got a good QST review sometime in the past year. Did that give you a bump?
Well, we got a QST review for a little HT7 AM handy talkie, and it's kind of a little toy, you know. It's not a serious contender in the transceiver market. But Sienna is, and this actually is the QST review unit right here. So as soon as this show is over, we're going to be finishing that thing up and sending it off to the league for testing. So it'll show up in a QST review here pretty soon.
Okay. Now, your sales are strictly from your own company? You're not through a dealer network?
Right.
Because ARRL and QST, when they do reviews, they typically buy anonymously.
Right.
Like it sounds like they...
Well, they couldn't do that in this
case.
They're
going to know...
What they did is they had a customer buy this and build it, and then in the time it took him to build it, we've actually done some upgrades. So he sent it back so we could do the upgrades, and then we'll ship it back to him for testing, and then he'll ship it on to the league.
Okay. So, and when you got it back in your hands, you put in all the special tweaks to make sure it was going to be perfect
for them, right? No. Well, I mean, obviously, we want it to be good, but it was built by a regular person just like you.
Was it Rich?
Huh?
Rich, the fellow I know from Raleigh?
No. It was built by Chuck Curran in, I think he's in Pennsylvania. I can't remember.
All right, so what else? See, we're on the wrong side for you to show me the rest of the products.
Well, let me show you the rear end of this thing first.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. This is our new low phase noise oscillator board. So some other companies have what they call an ultra low phase noise oscillator. We call this our hyper low phase noise oscillator. It's extremely quiet, very good low phase noise, and it's going to provide the oscillators for the transmitter and the receiver. In addition to that, we're making one more mod here. We're going to bring out a few more connectors on the rear panel, as well as the 10 megahertz in and out reference signals that'll be located right up here. So a bunch of new features, especially related to use of Sienna with an external receiver. There's a whole bunch of
Let's go back into camera range here. I was having a discussion with a ham on the air about phase noise. He said that none of the current receivers would beat his Collins S-Line or even an old Drake because of phase noise. I don't have the technical chops to argue with him, except they're not making those anymore, so what's the deal?
Well, phase noise is important because I can't really speak to whether Collins is any better or worse than we.
It has no phase noise because it's not synthesized.
All right. It has obviously very good quality oscillators because they had very good blocking dynamic range and sensitivity. What good phase noise buys you is blocking gain compression or blocking dynamic range. It's kind of the same measurement. That's when you have a really strong signal next to a really weak signal, mm-hmm. and the phase noise from the oscillator or from the signal, either one, mixes and produces noise that intersects with the weak signal. And so where you typically hear that is in a contest situation where you got really strong signals all over the band and you're trying to pick out really weak signals. If you have high phase noise, you can't hear the weak signals. So that's what it's all about, and that's why everybody's racing to produce the lowest phase noise oscillators.
Do I have the broad brush of the technology right? The phase noise is a product of synthesizers? Not, you wouldn't have
yeah,
them in
yeah, it is.
Full discrete oscillators?
You know, I don't have any discrete oscillators, so I don't really know about old oscillators, but today everything is synthesized.
Yeah.
You know, and so you're dealing with the specs of the parts that you've got available to you.
Do you think I will be right in saying that the today's really good receivers will hear signals that yesterday's really good receivers wouldn't hear?
I think so, yeah.
In those situations?
I mean, you can hear down to over minus 140 yeah. dBm.
So whoever you were I was arguing with on 2 meters, you're full of it. Maybe not.
Well, you know, the other thing to consider is, okay, it's a spec war to some extent because, okay, we can hear down to minus 140 and they can hear down to 143, but the band noise is minus 120. Say on 40 meters. So that extra margin isn't really buying anything.
Yeah.
Once you hit the limit of the band, you can't do any better than that. So we're talking about in a laboratory situation where you've got a test oscillator with really good performance that you're feeding into the antenna input and measuring the response of your receiver. So it's a measure of quality, obviously. The better you can do in that laboratory setting, the better receiver it is. That doesn't mean that it will sound any better on the air.
Yeah, once you connect an antenna to it,
right,
might not get that. All right, so what else have you got to show me? We need to go to the other side again?
Yeah, I guess
so. Move my camera.
Sure. Okay, so
what's our next toy?
Well, these are the only two products we manufacture other than the little AM handy talkie. But one thing I want to mention is we do offer the Sienna and the Sedona in customizable color schemes. So this particular one has blue LEDs and white keycaps. This one has green LEDs and white keycaps. We also offer it with gray keycaps, different color overlays. These are Lexan overlays, so you can get them in black or burgundy gray or all gray. A real popular one is the white keycaps with actually the gray keycaps with the blue LEDs on a black background looks really sharp.
Do you find that hams who are interested in this level of technology are also picky about what color the knobs and dials
are? Well, yeah, they are actually. You know, we're kind of conditioned to using black because all the Japanese radios are black. And so I offer it in black, but it actually, probably one of my more popular styles is this one with the gray and the burgundy and the yellow and just the normal green keycaps and green LEDs. So,
okay. I'm noticing that the display, let me go back here to the display, it's pretty simple.
Mm-hmm.
You're not doing a computerized screen display and a spectrum analyzer. Whoops, I see a spectrum analyzer.
Well, okay, so we don't obviously have a lot of room in this display. It is a bitmapped graphics display, so you can see the different filters as I select them. All right, and then you can shift them around. So there is some cool stuff you can do on this graphics display. It has a lot more stuff not actually showing in the display right now. RIT, ZIT, SPLIT. And it is cross-band, cross-mode, so you can actually have the transmit operating at a completely different frequency and band than the receiver. And a different mode, too. And they can be on at the same time. So we have full duplex. You can
transmit on one band, receive on the other band
at the same time.
Well, that's pretty cool. Single receiver, though, right?
It's single receiver, but it does have some hooks in it to allow use of an external receiver. There's this dual button here so that the internal receiver is fed to one speaker and whatever's coming in the line input goes to the other one. It's a fairly small unit. There isn't really room for another full receiver like the high quality receiver we got here. So we've made a provision to use another Sienna built as just a receiver. And then we've got all the necessary interconnects between the two to use it as a full dual receive.
So it can be built up as a more sophisticated system.
Right. So the way we handle the pan adapter situation is the IF output out of Sienna feeds into an SDR like the RF space SDR IQ that's mounted inside Sedona, and then it is controlled from the PC.
Okay, so we've just found a use for the utility box.
Right.
I thought we would come up with one at some point.
So we're actually running SpectraView software on the PC.
And of course, yeah, it's not
there. It is. So
this is a third-party application,
right,
but it integrates
RF space
well with your system.
Manufactures this radio here, and the software that goes with it. And there's a drop-down list there that lets you select the radio that you want to use, and Sienna is one of the selectable radios.
All right. Let's see. I'm going to bring you right back into television range here.
Okay.
What caused you to want to do this?
I used to work at Hewlett-Packard, and HP eventually morphed into Agilent Technologies. During the crash around the year 2000, they told everyone, you know, times are pretty tough and you might want to consider whether you want to do something else with your life. And they gave that to their credit. They gave us a lot of time to think about it. I never actually got laid off, but I thought about it a lot. And I said, you know, I really want to recreate the Heathkit experience for today's generation.
When was this?
That was around 2000.
So it's 15 years now.
Yeah, but it took 5 years to really get that idea fully fleshed out. And so I didn't start really thinking about the design of Sienna until about 05. Took several more years to actually get it into production, and it's taken the rest of the time to make sales, get feedback from customers, improve the manual, improve the product, and get it to where it is today. But it is really the only true soldering kit on the market, and the goal really is just to recreate that fun we all had as kids building our Heathkits.
Has it made a business for you? Is it
it's
income or
it is, yeah.
Does your wife think so?
You know, it's funny, she was if she was here right now, I had a customer yesterday who agreed to buy one of these, right? And I'm not set up to take credit cards here at Dayton. We do that online. I said, just, you know, go ahead and submit the order online, and I'll be waiting for it. My wife said, well, you know, you're so stupid. You really ought to take the money while the guy's standing right here, willing to give it to you. But, you know, it'll happen. It's
yeah, that is hard to do. That's, you know, one level of merchandising.
Right.
You get the 50 calls a day, I do, from merchant people trying to sell you credit card deals, don't you?
Oh, I know. And, you know, in this environment in Dayton, we're more in demo mode. We're not really in sales mode, so we're not set up to take credit cards. And plus, we would have to pay, you know, Ohio sales tax on every sale, and we don't have to do that online.
Ohio's a pain in the butt, too, I can tell you that. The couple times when I had a booth selling CDs or DVDs, it was a pain.
Yeah.
But you need to take a cue from the Elecraft guys over there that have a kit, but no solder. Because this year I noticed they have a whole table set up with just signing people up.
Oh, I know, they do
that.
It
seems very popular.
Yeah, they have a very large installed base, and they have very happy customers, and so do we, you know, but we're not a multi-million dollar company yet.
Yep. Okay, so where do people go if they want to learn more or lay down the cash on the line?
They go to www.dzkit.com. That's our main site to give you information about our products. ValleyHamShack.com is our e-commerce site. That's where you go to actually order stuff. And we have not only our own DZ Kit products there, but we have Heil, Alpha, Delta, Kent, and other products, ARRL publications that you can order online, as well as our radios.
Okay. So. I'm sure there's things you wish I would have asked about or will think about later, but is there anything top of mind right now that says, why didn't we talk about this?
No, not really.
We got it all.
I think we got a good product, and it's actually getting rave reviews. On the air, people are just raving about the quality of the audio. I have a lot of comments here that I brought to the show on the fun of the building experience. So I think we really did recreate the building experience.
What is this AM handy talkie you're talking about?
We make a little small handy talkie, and it's a
2 watt.
No, it's a 40 meter AM.
40 handy, meter AM.
40 meter AM. It operates on one frequency. It's the AM calling frequency.
What is that on 40?
It's like 7290. Bob Allison from ARRL did a review of it a few years ago. He hooked it up to their 100-foot tower with a beam on it, you know, on 40 meters, and worked people 200 miles away on this little AM handy
talkie. Well, it's the antenna, so.
Right. But the point is, you can hook an external antenna to it. It works just fine for, you know, around the house, around your yard type of communications as a little toy. It's fun to build, you know, so people can build it as a learning experience,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, so you get that brand-new young ham.
Right.
He's got to have the ham license because, you know, it's not on CB or FRS or something.
Right.
But he's got some cute little toy that can be all his.
That's right.
Yeah, so how much does that cost?
It's not cheap, you know, because it's got a high-quality chassis and good circuit boards, and it's a full-blown transceiver, but you know, you don't sell a lot of these things, obviously, so there's no real high volume, so it's a couple hundred dollars.
Okay, so it's going to be a little bit more than my first Heathkit C100.
Right.
Right.
Although adjusted for inflation, I don't know.
Yeah, it could
you
be
know,
about
if
the
you
same.
Look at the cost of a, you think about a $3,500 transceiver, and you go, wow, that's expensive, but an HW100 was $500, $400, something like that. You multiply by inflation, it's up in the $3,000 range today. So our memory is that the stuff was cheap, and it really wasn't all that cheap.
Yeah.
You know, it still took a bite out of your wallet, just like it does today.
And a $30 Chinese handy talkie is not making things look any better.
And that's not helping. I mean, we can't manufacture an empty box for $30. You know, I'm pretty sure they're heavily subsidized. There's no, the cost of the parts inside that thing has to be more than $30.
Yeah, yeah. I've got my thoughts on those. Not the time for them, but
right.
coming up. Thank you, Brian. Good luck with DZ Kits.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Cool. Cool looking stuff. I guess that's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Once again, back behind me is Arvin in his comfortable place on the Ham Radio Now shelf, wishing that I would take him with me next time I go on the road. Maybe I will, but probably not. Still watching out for the thunderstorms, so radio's not connected. It is tuned to 25 megahertz, the 1 kilowatt channel for WWV, because a ham out there said, because we can. Although I noticed as I was tuned in the other day and they were doing their ID, they still don't list the 25 megahertz transmission. You know, it's 2.5, 5, 10, 15, and 20 megahertz. And they're not listing the 25. What did I just say? They're not listing the 25. Anyway, so we're tuned in there. So hamradionow.tv, stop by and feed Arvin if you enjoy the program. Once again, if you've made it to this part of the program, you clearly enjoy them. And if you haven't helped out, and you can, you know, the rent's paid, the kids' college fund has its contribution this month, and you've been able to take the husband or the wife or significant other out to dinner once or twice in the past couple of weeks. Okay, then it's time to chip into Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. Over and out of here.